It's been a year since the COVID pandemic first impacted the laser tag industry and the world. International Laser Tag Day traditionally celebrates the anniversary of the industry on March 28th, but this year it also represents a light at the end of the tunnel and the resilience of the industry coming through it together. I'd like to welcome Eric Guthrie, curator of the Laser Tag Museum and founder of International Laser Tag Day. Hi, Eric.
Hello, hello. How are you today?
Very good. Now, why don't we start by talking a little bit about what is International Laser Tag Day and what is its purpose?
So International Laser Tag Day is the opportunity for operators throughout the world to promote laser tag, and specifically the founding and the beginning of laser tag. George Carter opened the very first photon laser tag in Dallas, Texas on March 28th, 1984. So March 28th of every year, we promote laser tag. And laser tag games throughout the world, and operators have joined us in that promotion, and it gives operators a chance to let the community know that laser tag is an important and valuable part of family entertainment.
Now, last year, there was no laser tag happening anywhere on Laser Tag Day. COVID has certainly made the past year very challenging for laser tag operators and the industry. So could you maybe just share a little bit about what things are looking like for the industry 1 year later?
So it's been a long year, and it's been a difficult year. However, the light is at the end of the tunnel. So for the past year, when COVID first started, most operators thought that this would be over within a matter of weeks. And I don't think it was just limited to the laser tag industry. I think the family entertainment industry as a whole thought it'd be over in a few weeks. But it kept going and going and going. And a number of states experienced lockdowns, shutdowns, everything to help stop the spread of the disease. But in our industry, where we rely on people coming together to create the experience, it had a disastrous impact. By my estimates, I would tell you that roughly 25% of family entertainment centers with laser tag have shut down. And that's either bowling center, skating, standalone laser tag, sports venue, anything that had laser tag. I would say 25% of those laser tags are gone, and other industries suffered even worse than we did.
Well, from your vantage point, what do you see for the industry going forward as far as the near future and also long-term?
So the positive, and even today, I talked to an operator out of Omaha, Nebraska that has just reported phenomenal numbers. More and more operators, regardless of laser tag system, are reporting increased sales. In the past probably 6 weeks or so, 8 weeks, more operators are espousing optimism. They believe that the light is at the end of the tunnel. They believe that we have started into a new chapter. Birthday party bookings are up. I personally today booked a 25-person church group for my laser tag venue in Toledo. So we're seeing more of that, and more operators are reporting increased sales. And I would say overall, most operators are reporting about 80 to 85% of where they were pre-COVID. And that's very positive, given that last summer, most operators were, if they were open, were reporting 10 to 20% of their sales from the same time the year prior.
And of course, many of them were on different timelines as far as when they were able to reopen, and some may still not be open, correct?
That is very correct. I mean, you look at states like New York, California, Massachusetts, they really suffered hard, you know, for openings, and some locations are still not open. There's a number of operators that want to reopen, and just due to local government or state regulations, they cannot open.
What would you say have been some of the biggest challenges for operators, and how are they overcoming them?
Well, the most apparent one, obviously, is convincing the public that laser tag is safe from a sanitary point of view. So operators today now have, you know, elements on their website where they say, this is how we sanitize our packs. And operators have produced YouTube videos and put on their websites on how they sanitize their packs. Ozone generators that are run at night in the laser tag arena to help disinfect those, capacity limitations. And we are an industry that had relied on a large amount of people, you know, coming into a limited space, and all of our ROIs were based off of that. Now, to be able to only run 50% capacity in that same space has a direct impact on overall profitability.
Are there things that are being done industry-wide that are giving people some further comfort about the safety of laser tag?
I think overall the whole industry has adapted this concept that laser tag is still fun for groups. Probably running more smaller groups. Games are probably a little shorter so they can get the turn through that they need to when they are busy. But I would say right now, the big thing industry-wide is that the operators are saying that laser tag is still fun and safe for groups. And I think now the public is listening. I think the public themselves want to go do group and social activities. We're tired of staying at home. So I think operators are tapping into that quite nicely.
One of the things that makes laser tag a little unique as far as being able to keep a social distance is the amount of space per player. Could you speak to that a bit?
Yeah, certainly. I mean, my own facility has a 4,000 square foot laser tag arena and I can run up to 32 players at once, but now I'm only running 16, 15 to 16, in a game. And so where we were saying that you needed 150 square feet per player in laser tag arena designs, our operators are now in essence giving the player 250 to 300 square feet per player. So it's been pretty wild at how empty laser tag arenas look, especially some operators like to have inside cameras that are streamed to the web or to their website. And they just look, kind of empty, even when they've only got, half capacity. So it's going to change, I think, arena design moving forward. I think that's an interesting, feature set out there. Do arenas need to be as large as they have been moving forward? Will two levels become more inherently valuable to the guest experience because you can now spread people out both top and bottom, where in the past 5 years, we've seen a move where arenas are moving to 1.5 levels. So you're still keeping them single level, maybe a small change of elevation. Now I'm wondering if the next 5 years, we don't see two level arenas becoming more predominant again. So I think the arena design industry is gonna have something, really challenges moving forward. I think you're gonna see more open arenas, less of the rat maze, tight walls concept, more visibility, because we now wanna know where people are in proximity to us. So I think that'll be interesting for the industry moving forward.
So much laser tag had started down the path of going into the family entertainment center model. Do you think that what we've experienced is going to have any bearing on that model continuing versus the standalone arena style?
Well, the standalone industry, has already been on a diminishing, model for quite some time. Even in this, weirdly, in this COVID situation, I think the mammals kind of outlasted the dinosaur, and bear with me on that. Some of the standalones were small enough that they could sustain themselves by a low break-even point compared to some of these 50,000, 60,000 square foot fun centers or entertainment centers. Their overhead was so large and so high that, we saw that, massive fun centers start closing down, entertainment bowling centers start to close down. And yet some of these smaller venues under 10,000 square feet were able to survive. They limited their hours, they reduced their workforce, but they were still able to make ends meet because their rents were much smaller. Whereas some of these venues that were large couldn't sustain themselves.
What are some of the creative things you're seeing operators doing as to be picking up and moving forward to rebuild their business?
So, I think we're back to this, I don't want to say the same old, but the tried and true elements here, other than really promoting how well they disinfect the packs and how well they clean the arenas, limiting the game size. I think we're still seeing church groups coming back out. We're still seeing birthday parties on the uptick. We're still seeing casual date, groups coming in. And I think as long as the operators cater to kind of the basics that have sustained the laser tag industry for 37 years now, I think as long as they stay focused on the core principles, they're doing well. It's the operators that went too far into membership, thinking, oh, members are going to be the savior for my industry, my, you know, my facility, or we're just going to cater to adults and we don't care about kids. I think those operators are suffering as well. While we can't be all things to all people, we should still be something to most.
So we're coming up on International Laser Tag Day. Why would you say that International Laser Tag Day, particularly this year, is so important to recognize, even as some operators are still unable to open to full capacity?
Well, even if they're not able to operate at full capacity, I think that this is a chance for operators to rally around a cause, a symbol to help get the awareness out, because we're always concerned about out of sight, out of mind. So by operators embracing International Laser Tag Day and offering a $5 game or some sort of, you know, discount on laser tag or, you know, extended laser tag game times or any number of things that operators can do to promote International Laser Tag Day, it gives them a word to get out into the market, to get people to be aware. You know, it gives them one more item on social media for people to pay attention to their facility. So I think from that point, it's positive. And I think from the operator's position here, that chance to say to people, laser tag is still a great experience. I think because people will look at this and go, hey, here's a chance to go do something we haven't done in a long time. And the operator's giving them that motion, that motive by going through and promoting International Laser Tag Day.
And let's talk a little bit about the poster design and the concept behind it this year. Tell me a little bit about how this year's poster differs from the past.
So ever since 2014, when we started International Laser Tag Day, we celebrated the 30th anniversary of one of the manufacturers. And our very first one was the 30th anniversary of Photon. In the 2016 poster, we celebrated the 30th anniversary of the toy Worlds of Wonder laser tag. So over the years, we just simply looked at the 30th anniversary of a major contributor to the laser tag industry. This year, we deviated from our past practices and we put together a poster that has a number of the major laser tag manufacturers throughout the world on this one poster. And we're promoting the idea that we're all in this together, because we are all in this together. Laser tag manufacturers theoretically are competitors, but a lot of people don't realize we're actually really colleagues. We get together and have a great time. Laser tag operators who come to the laser tag convention, they don't care whose equipment is on the wall. They care about best practices and ways to promote sales in their laser tag facility. So our poster this year reflects a completely different outlook. And we're now promoting the idea that we're all in this together and we should all celebrate this event because at the end of the day, we are united as an industry.
I think that theme is exactly the right message for this moment in time. And one other thing I know is different is rather than printing the posters, you're making it available as a digital download.
We are, but let me throw in, because you don't give me your questions ahead of time, and I like that. But we developed this concept that we're all in this together based on a phone call with you. If I hadn't had that phone call with you, we would not have come up with this theme. So first off, on behalf of the industry, I want to say thank you for the inspiration. We appreciate that tremendously. So now to your question. Partially due to timing and partially due to COVID practices, while we're safe, and actually I got my shot today, while we're safe here at the Laser Tag Museum, we wondered what it was like to mail posters and tubes throughout the whole world and how people would receive that on a hygienic basis. And would we have issues getting mail or these posters into other countries like we have in the past? We've been able to ship them without issues in the past. So this year we've gone to a digital download. We've got high res images available where operators go to our website and they're able to register and they can download this marketing kit. And that we've got a link to a company called shortrunposters.com. Now we're not affiliated with them. They don't know we're doing this, but it's where I order posters for my laser tag facilities. So we've got a link to them. And for like $8 or $9, you can get these posters printed and shipped to you, through shortrunposters.com. So we've gone a different route. Operators can get them printed and have them within a couple of days and they can hang them in their facility. So it's a different way to distribute, but it's a different world we live in now.
And where can the operators go to get this digital download?
So at this stage, anyone can wants to post or can. In the past, we've limited to laser tag operators, but now it's because it's digital, all the more people can have it. And they can just simply go to www.lasertagmuseum.com. And then there's a big image on the front page. Just click on that, and you'll be able to download the poster images. But lasertagmuseum.com.
Very good. Is there anything else you'd like to share about Laser Tag Day or anything going on?
I had a conversation with George Carter not too long ago. He's doing very well. He's pretty surprised at the resilience of the laser tag industry. He's happy that a product that he created watching Star Wars in 1977 still resonates with millions of people all over the world. And that's always refreshing. I've talked to a number of manufacturers. They feel that they'll be able to survive the, this COVID situation. So we're not expecting to lose any laser tag manufacturers. So that's positive for the industry as well. So despite the economic impact of COVID, and it personally impacted the museum, we've been closed, not available to be open to the public. It's impacted my own stores. We're all very, very optimistic that, we're pretty much through the worst of it, and we expect to see better days in the future, very near future.
Absolutely. And one of those days, no question, is March 28th. So I hope lots of people will go out and play laser tag on International Laser Tag Day. And I want to thank you for joining me today. That's Eric Guthrie, curator of Laser Tag Museum and founder of International Laser Tag Day. Thank you, Eric.
Thank you very much.